Okay, we're going to start. Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to the second session of this morning, a session under the theme of new tools and the global R&D landscape. My name is Elster Rehle. I work at the Open Society Foundations, where I direct the Access to Essential Medicines initiative. But as many of you know here in this room, I have a long-standing relation with both MSF and DNDi. The slide with the fatal imbalance report that was put up this morning was one of these reports I contributed to, and that set up in motion a whole range of things, including the setup of DNDi, in which I was involved and a staff member for many years. And now, since recently, I joined the board of DNDi, so I have a lot of relations with both MSF and DNDi. I have the pleasure to have with me here a very distinguished panel to discuss indeed the global R&D landscape and how it has evolved. I will quickly present them now. We have Carlos Morel with us from Brazil, the scientific coordinator at the Center for Technological Development at the Oswaldo Cruz Foundation, or Fiocruz. We have Jean-Hervé Bradol from MSF, who is now research director at one of MSF's think tanks called CRASH. We have John Arne Rottinger, who is currently visiting professor global health and population at the Harvard School of Public Health, but also recently was the chair of the WHO Consultative Expert Working Group on Research and Development, on which we will hear more during the session. And I'm going continuing the line here. We have Lucy Cheshire, who is the current director of the TB Action Group in Kenya, representing patient advocates. We have James Love. We have Christian Luc, who is the Director General of the International Vaccine Institute. And at the end of the table, we have James Love, the Director of Knowledge Ecology International. And so I just want to summarize the objective of this session is. So we will review the evolving R&D landscape and the related policy discussions that happened over the past number of years, and review how we as a community have done in responding to the needs of neglected patients. And with that, we want to critically reflect on where we are going with that. And are we doing enough? Should we do more? Would that be more of the same? Do we want to make adjustments, or do we think that actually a little bit more radical changes might be needed? And try to start a conversation about what would these changes, which I anticipate we will think are needed, what would they look like? And so as you listen, all of you, to the panel, I would like everybody to reflect on what this would mean for you in moving forward in 2013. So whether you are a biomedical researcher, a drug developer, a clinician, a policymaker, a donor, a health activist, what this conversation means in terms of what you will do differently in your job, in your conversations, in your thinking, in moving this forward. And so what will you do when you walk out of this conference that will help develop us moving all together in the right direction? And so maybe just a few words how we're going to do the session. We will start with three 10-minute presentations, and I'm saying 10 minutes with the emphasis on not more than 10, by Carlos, Jean-Hervé, and John Arne. And then I will kick off a panel discussion by asking specific questions to the three discussants, and that will enable us to start a conversation in which I also would like at some point to involve the audience. And so I really want to ask all the panelists here to be short, concise, and precise with the time, because we don't have so much time, and we are between you and lunch, and people are already starting feeling hungry. So without further ado, I would like to invite Carlos to present, with a view from the South, what steps have been taken over the past period in terms of research and development for neglected patients.
Good morning. First of all, I'd like to thank to MSF and DNDI for this kind invitation. And what I'm going to try to say to you today is a vision from the South which might be as different as this map. I think we're not familiar with this kind of upside down. But let me start by recalling you some of the early initiatives in this area. TDR in 1975, and putting the picture of the first. Ken Warren, which was a key person at the Rockefeller Foundation with the great neglects of mankind. Unfortunately, today you enter the website of Rockefeller, don't see anything, but he did something very important in these initiatives. But I would like to call your attention that it was not only international initiatives. Brazil had an initiative in the 70s that called PIDE that made a lot of progress on Chagas, which finally led to the Organization of National Chagas Disease Control Program and the Southern Cone Initiative in collaboration with PAHO and TDR. But this was in 1973, even before TDR had been created. Well, then in the 90s, you got a lot of partnerships. This was the start of the initiatives of partnerships, all these PDPs, some early ones like the TDR and PATH, CORED, IAVI. But I think it was really in the 2000s that they took over as a critical new way to try to develop new interventions to neglect diseases. And I would say the creation of DNDI was a marker, as the MEV and the other, but Bill and Melinda Gates. So all these kind of complex organizations start doing another approach to intervention development. And giving you some examples or some success stories. MMV has now distributed CoRTEM, the anti-malarial combination therapy, to over 140 million people in 35 countries in Africa. I would say this is a success story. Tomorrow, Mel Spiegelman is going to speak to us about the portfolio of TB drug development. And you are going to see lots of new regimens almost going to phase three. So we think that there will be some good news in TB in the next years. DNDI, together with my institution, DNDI, we developed the combination between artesunate and mefloquine, which was developed in partnership in Brazil, then transferred to Cipla in India, and today has been tested in several of these countries. Well, I like very much this phrase by Bloom, by Barry Bloom. In this paper in 2006, he said, oh, there's too many initiatives, too many people, but there is no architecture of global health. I think that was okay at that time, but I would like to question a bit because if you see, this is the way science is being done today. In some centuries ago, science was an initiative from one person in isolation. Later on, it started collaboration. Today, you do science as a network. You have some papers with more than 1,000 authors. And if you see how PDPs are working, this is from a document from DFID, UK. Look how many PDPs interact with big pharma, small pharma, and biotech. It's almost impossible to draw a structure. So I think that we have to speak about collaborative networks instead of structure. Well, recent evolution. I would like you to pay attention to this graph. This is one of the graphs that it would be to take home. You see, in the left side, this is the year WHO was created. And this graph is from GapMinder, nice software from Rosling. It's life expectancy and against income per person. You see that there are, in 48, the rich and the poor. But today, you have the rich, the poor, and the BRICS, you have the IDCs, and so on. So the world's completely different. And some people still reason as north and south. From the G Finder, you already see India and Brazil as among the top funders. So this award change, and I bet that these numbers are underestimations because there are other ways that Brazil finds funds research. I'd like to give one example from a South-South cooperation, which I'd like you to think it as a possible new way to collaborate. And this is what we did in collaboration with Mozambique, Brazil and Mozambique, to create a new drugs factory in Mozambique. You can imagine how difficult this is. Where in 2003, President Lula went to Mozambique and then came back saying, guys, I need you to start thinking of an antiretroviral plant in Mozambique. We said, my God, that is going to be really difficult. Anyway, which were the objectives? Was to create a public sustainable pharmaceutical industry focusing on antiretrovirals in order to support the public policy of Mozambique. And these were the main actors. From Brazil, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Minister of Health, Anvisa, which is our FDA, and my institution, Fiocruz, and my institution, Farmanguinhos, which is our pharmaceutical production branch. We have here one of the former directors, Eluan Pinheiro, and one of the DNDI colleagues, Jean-René Kichel, who has helped us a lot. But also pay attention to this slide. This was our investment. This was the investment from Brazil, from Mozambique, and Vale Foundation is a Brazilian foundation from a big ore company that also helped us in this area. So it was over $30 million invested in this plant. This was the chronogram, start 2003, and it's going to go until 2017. But we did a lot of capacity building. People were trained there in Mozambique, but also in Rio de Janeiro, in our factory in Rio. And in 2012, the operation started. And this plant is being considered one of the best well-equipped. It's not yet full operation, it's in process. Certification starts now. But we think that by 2017, we are going to have six antiretrovirals and something like 15 generic drugs. So, but there are some challenges. It's not easy to make this happen. These are some of the challenges that we have, keeping a strong diplomatic relationship. Also, the culture are too different. In Brazil, we have a law that obliges everybody to be treated, not in Mozambique. So this is a big problem. But there are other problems, and I would like to stress this last one. Pressure from donors who do not understand the need for pulp production medicines in a poor African country. You see, I think in a South-South cooperation, Brazil and Mozambique did a very nice initiative. I think this shows that it can be done. Now the sustainability, we would like really to share with others. And for instance, in the next 7 years, for the fact to become sustainable, people would need an investment of $10 million in 5 years, $2 million a year. I don't think this is too much. I would like to see how some donors which are not used to this kind of initiative would react to that. But I would like to show this to you because we think that we have to think out of the box. There are some initiatives from the South that can be progressed. The world is very different, and I think partnerships and networks are the way to go. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Carlos, in particular, for really keeping well up with the time. So I will immediately hand over to Jean Hervé, who has been involved in an analysis looking at what the output has been of all these initiatives that Carlos was mentioning.
So, in 2002, Patrice Trouillet and colleagues published that only 1% of all drugs approved over the period between 75 and 99 were for a group of diseases accounting for 12% of the global health burden. So facing this situation, a lot of new initiatives were launched, and we tried to reassess today the outcome of these initiatives in both terms, in terms of approved products, but also in terms of still ongoing research. So we selected our list of neglected diseases out of existing already existing list, the WHO list for neglected tropical diseases, Patrice Trouillet and Peter Otte's publication, the PLOS Neglected Tropical Diseases Journal, on the G-Finder report, and the BioVenture for Global Health report. We've put them in 5 categories: tuberculosis, malaria, diarrheal diseases, neglected diseases according to WHO list, and other neglected diseases. We searched for all products approved across all indications in between 2000 and 2011. Sources were European and US databases, and also databases of stringent authorities, countries belonging to the Pharmaceutical Inspection Convention and Pharmaceutical Inspection Cooperation Team. We also look into the WHO list of pre-qualified medicinal products on the WHO essential medicine list. New products were classified into 5 categories: new chemical entities, new indication, new formulation, fixed dose combination, and vaccine or biological product. The WHO essential medicine list was used as a proxy measure of the medical benefit for a given product. We've tried to assess the percentage of new product developed by therapeutic area or disease. We measure the deviation from the expectation under the assumption of proportionality to DALYs. Well, in terms of health burden, we view this very famous indicator and disability-adjusted life years, and we've tried to assess if the number of new products was proportionate to the proportion of disability-adjusted life years for a certain disease. We've identified marketing authorization holders. It was roughly possible, except for those who are products that are only registered in the WHO essential medicine list. For clinical trials analyses, we've screened both registries from NIH and WHO, and we were looking for ongoing phase 1-3 clinical trials. We took a snapshot at the end of December 2011 about these ongoing clinical trials. Clinical trial sponsors were classified into public institutions, private not-for-profit organizations, private industry, and multiple sponsors. Our result, we found during that period 850 new products, being drugs and vaccines. Once again, we didn't screen for diagnostics. Among them, 37 were for neglected diseases, 4.4%, including 29 drugs, 8 vaccines. Under the assumption of proportionality to the DALYs, to the health burden, we would have been expected 89. There is a deficit in this period of 52, which is still a very significant deficit compared to the disease burden, especially if we recall that the previous study period of 25 years between 75 and 99 was a desert in terms of new drugs for neglected diseases. So meaning we have to catch up, and the catching up is there but a bit slow. It's even a bit worse for new chemical entities. Only 1% of them are dedicated to neglected diseases during that period. Over the 37 products, 12 are for malaria, including 3 of the 4 new chemical entities, and these 3 are artemisinin derivatives, and it's hard to pretend that they were really new during that period. No, not a single new chemical entity was developed for tuberculosis or any neglected tropical diseases during that period. Vaccine and biologics were for Japanese encephalitis, rotavirus and cholera, and one antivenom for snake bite. Medical benefits through the proxy of the inclusion on the essential medicine list, we found that close to half of the product for neglected diseases were included, compared to only 4% for all other diseases. Alors, in terms of registration order, a large majority of new product registration filed up by regional generic or public pharmaceutical company, including 12 by Indian laboratories. Seven new products registration filed up by large private pharmaceutical company. I mean it, the comeback of Big Pharma on that field that they have abandoned more than 10 years ago. Clinical trials. We found roughly 150,000 clinical trials, only 1.4% for neglected diseases. Out of them, we've identified 123 new products, and among them, a bit more than half of them are vaccines, as Anthony Fauci stressed. On most of these vaccines, one third of these vaccines are against malaria. The good news is that there is a bit of new products for new tropical diseases, neglected tropical diseases. Study sponsorship for the 123 products still under development. Public organization accounting for 55%, private non-for-profit organization for 15%, private industry for 22%, and the remainder are involving a mix of sponsors. Alors, we can see also that the private non-for-profit organization are playing a significant role in the field of development of new products for neglected tropical diseases. It's a bit more than half of the product under development. They also play an important role in developing new chemical entities for the same diseases. Of course, there are limitations to our study. We took a broad definition of neglected diseases, but still we've excluded HIV/AIDS, bacterial meningitis and pneumonia and rheumatic fever. The dailies as an indicator of health burden underestimate neglected diseases. They are neglected, so they are poorly studied. And in our search for in databases, we didn't take into consideration China, for instance, and we all know that we could have a lot of surprises coming from China. WHO essential medicine list favors infectious diseases and low-cost products, so the inclusion as a, in that list as a proxy for measuring the medical benefit as a bias, but you have seen the factor, it's more than a factor 10, so even with a bias, that's clear that the research for neglected diseases is bringing a lot of medical benefit both for patients and practitioners. Alors, what we found quantitatively is roughly consistent with the literature, but previous publications were based on different lists, different databases, so it's not statistically comparable per se. But within our own study, in between approved product and product still under development, we can see a rise. For approved product, it was an average of 2.4 per year. And we predict, based on usual published attrition rates about pharmaceutical research on infectious diseases drugs, to get a 4.7, close to 5, average new product per year in the next coming 6 years. Well, you have seen a persistent imbalance between disease burden and product development for neglected diseases is there. Positive advances were primarily based on reformulation, repurposed products, and vaccines. On that way of teaching an old dog new trick will be certainly important when we switch to non-communicable diseases, drug development for resources limited settings. But at the end, we remain with a very small number of new chemical entities for neglected diseases. And among neglected diseases, some of them are much more neglected than others. In a way, malaria, tuberculosis, and diarrheal diseases start being covered. Not completely, of course, but you also have some neglected diseases with no attention on no project in under development at all, like mycetome, for instance. Thank you for your attention. Just a word, it's of course a collective work submitted to a review for publication. The two main investigators, Belen Pedriquet and Claudette Sommet. Belen is a medical doctor and an epidemiologist, and Claudette is a university pharmacist. They both dedicated their professional career to the fight against neglected diseases. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much. And can I now invite our last presenter, John Arne, who will explain a little bit more about the policy discussions that have happened basically over the last 10 years, but in particular in the context of the consultative expert working group that he has been chairing over the last 1 or 2 years.
Yeah, first I would like to thank MSF and DNDi and Mount Sinai for inviting me. And in a way, it's for me, it's like coming home. I did research myself within infectious disease epidemiology back 10, 15 years ago. But I should say that the last 5, 6 years, I've been in another landscape. So the first session today really was important for me to understand that behind these large numbers, either patients or millions or billions of investments, there are individual patients. Patients we cannot treat, patients we treat with unsuitable kind of drugs that we need to treat for a long time, lots of side effects, they don't adhere to the treatments, and treatments have become ineffective, so we need new investments. That's the reality. I would actually talk to you about one concept, delinkage. I will talk about that as an important separation between how we pay and fund research and development and innovation, and how we should pay and fund manufacturing and thereby the prices of products. But there is also an unfortunate chasm, I would say, and that's the kind of the separation and the unfortunate delinkage between the doers, those of you who do research, and those of us, like myself, who more like to talk about it. We are kind of the partly self-appointed or kind of maybe appointed vice guys who kind of run in meetings in Geneva and otherwhere to talk about the need for increased investments. And I think we really need to bridge and link those communities, the doers and the talkers. So I hope my talk can help doing that. This is a quote from a recent BMJ blog by MSF representatives. What happened now is that 10 years backwards, this was the journey through time that representatives from governments around the world took. It brought us 10 years back in time. Proposals will be shelved for almost 4 more years while countries hide behind excuses. This seems to be a catastrophe. And I guess only a minority of you know what I'm talking about. And that's a delinkage. So what I'm talking about is the process at the World Health Organization, starting with the Commission on Intellectual Property Rights, Innovation and Public Health, which was initiated in 2003, which produced a commission report that then went into a negotiation process in the so-called IGWiG group of the World Health Organization, a working group, but more or less a kind of a 1,000 people negotiation process over 2 years, which produced a global strategy and plan of action. Then there have been 2 follow-up expert working groups, and I will come back to those. But just to delve with the global strategy and plan of action, the main concern and the main remaining issue not resolved in the global strategy and plan of action is to secure adequate and sustainable financing for research and development and improve coordination of its use. So I will present to you some key ideas and key recommendations of the last expert working group. And start with the very simple concept. This is the standard model of how we do research and development. The costs are for the pre-competitive phase, it's for the development phase, and it's for production. These are the costs we need to pay for as a global society. We do this by paying mostly public funds for the pre-competitive period, and then we pay by high prices on products for the combination of development and production. And then that's as long as the products are on patent, and then when they are off patent, we get much lower prices because there is competition. What we propose in, and this is of course an idea that has been around for a long time, we propose delinking the development, the paying for development and the payment for production. Because what has been proposed by many is to kind of do risk sharing. And in many ways, risk sharing can partly be to subsidize a development process. But what we then cannot guarantee is that the price levels of products are affordable. So we propose the key principle of delinking and securing public funding for the development phase, thereby relying on competition in production. So the key basic underlying ideas of the consultative expert working group is to use free open market competition in production to assure affordability. This requires delinking of R&D costs and prices of products. But at the same time, such a principle requires upfront public financing of R&D and innovation. And the consequence is that it re-establishes R&D products and new knowledge as a global public good. Just a brief summary of the key recommendations. We propose more use of open source approaches and open licensing approaches to R&D. We propose using milestone and end prices as a way of incentivizing R&D, more use of patent pools, and kind of coined this term open knowledge innovation, more sharing and collaborative work within this area of research. To make this happen, we need financing commitments and we need a pool funding mechanism. And we need more information on the R&D landscape, and we need advisory or coordination mechanisms at the World Health Organization. And altogether, this constitutes a global framework for R&D for neglected diseases. But we cannot deliver, we believe, without having that framework in a more solid way. And we proposed a convention on global health R&D as one of the key implementing mechanisms of our recommendations. I will dwell a bit on financing. What we suggested is that all countries should step up and co-fund these efforts. And the best way is to contribute in a fair way, and we proposed 0.01% of GDP. Most of this funding could go through countries' own systems, but at least 20% and up to 50% should go through a pooled funding mechanism globally to improve coordination and reduce duplication of work. What is the current state? And we just described this. This is almost the updated GFinder data. If we measure countries towards this target of 0.01% of GDP, very few countries, and more or less only the USA, is meeting that target today. If we kind of measure it compared to the public funding of health R&D, in total public funding, which is the blue bars here, and then I kind of use the funding for neglected diseases as red bars, you see there's a big variation. And if you see this scatter plot, you see there is a kind of a trend line with the best countries being on the margin, but there are many countries that seem to invest more in general on health research but are not stepping up to contribute to global efforts. So what has happened? Very briefly, what has happened at the World Health Organization with these recommendations? So first, in May, the World Health Assembly welcomed the report and suggested that there needs to be more discussions on how to improve monitoring, coordination, and financing of research for the needs of developing countries. So that's the resolution. Just 2 weeks ago, member states came together in an open-ended intergovernmental negotiation process, and they drafted a resolution, which I've just picked some highlights from. And this is draft resolution, but it will go through the executive board and probably be decided then by the World Health Assembly in May next year. It says member states themselves urge that they should increase their own investments in health R&D for diseases that disproportionately affect developing countries. Then they say that the WHO Secretariat, or the Director General, should develop norms and standards for classification of health R&D, should establish a global health R&D observatory, should start and facilitate demonstration projects or pilots within this area, should explore and assess current coordination mechanisms and funding mechanisms, and develop a concrete proposal for effective mechanisms, including a pooled funding model. So in many ways, that's a success. But what I urge you to do is to improve the second part, the linkage. So link how these global promises now can make your work better. How can we link the new promises with the needs of those working in the R&D and innovation system of the health needs of low-income countries? Because we need your voice if this will be turned into real concrete actions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, John Arne, for a very comprehensive discussion of a topic that indeed many people don't really are not so familiar with, but is critically important in the rest of our conversations. So I think from these three presentations, it's clear that quite a lot has been accomplished. I mean, there is an R&D pipeline. The output has been, let's say, not very spectacular, but the pipeline looks much more promising. We've heard about a whole variety of new actors and mechanisms that have come into existence, and partnerships and networks in particular that are interested in looking into global health issues related to neglected populations. We've heard about the success of today's shared analysis that we now have through this long process that culminated in the CEWG report that we just heard about, and recommendations on ways forward, however, recommendations who have yet to be put into practice, of course. But we've also heard in the previous session that we still have real burning health needs that remain unaddressed and underaddressed. And so the question for us now, and that we need to grapple with today and tomorrow, is as John Arne was also saying, what needs to change in what we are doing now to actually move from the discourse into action, and an action that results in an impact for the patients? Because I think that, and we will hear about that, for many of the patients that we all talk about and we all care about, the last 10 years may not have brought so much impact yet. And so how can we accelerate that? How can we do that better? How can we do that different? And how can we move from what I think has been the ad hoc creation of initiatives and pilot projects from which we are learning, and we should learn more, into something that leads us to a systemic change, a sustainable way of addressing the health needs of the people, and it's no longer about the poor people in developing countries, but as was mentioned several times already this morning, it's actually the health needs of many people living in all countries, also in rich countries, in middle-income countries, in poor countries, for those people, populations who are actually neglected by the current market-driven system. And I would like to start with asking Lucy, from the patient perspective, I think it's very clear from what we heard already this morning that the last decades of R&D have not delivered the needed tools for tuberculosis, certainly not for drug-resistant tuberculosis. And so based on your experience, and then, for instance, specifically with extrapulmonary TB, what tools do you need to become available? And then thinking further, as a patient advocacy group, and talking to all the patient advocates and the activists here in the room, what is it that the patient activists can contribute into discussion to actually answer to also the question of the, that I know it's no longer on the screen, but it's here. How can the linkage between those that talk and those that do be established, and what is the voice of the patients in there? So take a couple of minutes to kick off our panel debate.
Thank you very much. Quite interesting, because I think I'm happy to be here. Just to say thanks to MSF and DNDI for inviting me to be here. That's quite an interesting question, because I must say today I'm actually celebrating 20 years ever since I got to know my HIV status, and 10 years having been on antiretroviral drugs, considering that I almost died from TB. And one thing while the presentations were actually being made stood out for me is how better can we actually link the scientific evidence that we have today with the issue which is pertinent to patients at country level, which is one, using the component of country dialogue. It's unfortunate because in the 21st century, what we've basically seen in the last decade is that a lot of the initiatives have been top down and pretty prescriptive. But here, if we really have to make the difference, one is we need to figure out how better can we work with patient groups to be able to push that agenda at country level, so that at the end of the day, using an example of my own country, Kenya, whereby one of the discussions that we are having right now with the parliamentary health committees and the parliamentary finance committees is how do we work together collectively to enhance a health fund that would actually go a long way in addressing some of the domestic resources that are needed in country. And I guess that is a conversation that is pertinent, and patients have to take it up and be at the center of the discussions. And I just want to highlight the issue of the scientific evidence and some of the research that has gone into the work that has happened globally in relation to TB, and recognizing the work that the Treatment Action Group has done, which is basically a patient-led organization, which for the last almost 5-6 years has actually been giving us up-to-date information on where is the money for research and development coming in. And it's quite unfortunate that in 2012, we still have only about 81 partners that are actually providing money that are needed for new tools in the context of research and development. And therefore, when you think about to date, we are in a funding crisis. Only about $650 million has actually been raised to be able to go into new drugs, new vaccines, and new diagnostics for TB, even despite the fact that there's amazing tools out there that like GeneXpert that have come a long way in actually shortening the duration in terms of the diagnostics. So the basic question really is, how better can we work with patient groups in country one so that we can hold our governments accountable, have these conversations candidly with governments that they recognize the need to be able to invest in research and development at the end of the day, looking at how better can we use the aspect of knowledge transfer between countries where we are seeing great models that are basically effective, and just citing the example of what's going on in Ethiopia with the aspect of the community health workers approach. And I'm happy because in my own country, one of the things that a lot of the patient organizations are basically doing is that in recruitment of community health workers, priority is always given to people living with HIV and people who've had TB. And this is critical because not just using your own perspective of having gone through the disease, but actually showing the community that without combining efforts and ensuring that communities and patients are at the center of all these initiatives, then we still have a long, long way to be able to go. And then, of course, not forgetting the issue of partnerships. Partnerships are really key. I remember my first opportunity I had when I was a board member on the Stop TB partnership. It was really difficult. The TB community never believed that they could partner with patients to be able to do policy, to have the international policy dialogue, to be able to do the domestic resources for health, et cetera. And so one of the things that I took as a priority when I was on the Stop TB Partnership Board it was actually quite lonely because, one, I came in from a nutrition background, very little information on TB, despite the experience that I had suffered TB. And it was quite a challenge convincing the clinicians around the table and even the technocrats that patients had something to offer. And it took us almost 4 years to have those kind of conversations. And it was until about 2006 when we had the first global plan to stop TB internationally, whereby at the end of the day, we had the creation of the different working groups within the Stop TB partnership. And that basically became an opportunity to have the patient representatives on the different working groups. And that has gone a long, long way in actually getting us to where we are in terms of, one, raising the profile of TB, secondly, the scale-up of TB HIV interventions, which has really, really been slow in a number of countries. And when I look back and actually even think about the World Health Organization report that was released recently on TB, you're actually seeing that there's progress being made up when it comes to scaling up TB HIV interventions, and this is something that was not happening, but we are now seeing a lot of PLHIVs and TB patients who are going out to the communities, talking to their peers and saying, you know what, we need to do something, and we've got to do it collectively with government. We come in to complement government efforts and at the end of the day be able to actually go a long, long way in ensuring that this happens. And then of course, lastly, thinking about how better can we use the scientific evidence to actually enhance the country dialogue? Because without doing that, it's going to be really, really difficult for us to go to the next phase, whereby countries need to feel that they're at the center of the discussions that are basically taking place. And I just came back from a Global Fund board meeting, and one unique thing about the Global Fund right now is the aspect around country dialogue, and how is that country dialogue going to take place? Are we going to be very honest as donors, partners in country, and in thinking about what kind of resources are we bringing around the table, and actually having the countries to decide to say, it's true, this is USG money, this is JICA money, but this is how we would want you to fund, or these are the priorities for the country, and in that being able to align it. And I'm just hoping that we can continue to have the candid conversations that are currently taking place, because without really thinking about the implications and the benefits at country level, which would go a long, long way in even minimizing some of the costs that exist out there, because you can imagine if we had all the partners coming around the table and declaring and saying, this is what we are investing. One, we are going to minimize duplication of activities across the different bilateral partners, if there are any that exist at the moment. And then secondly, we are going to see much more increased integration at country level, which I think for me is actually the missing piece also. And we've got to see patients taking that up and ensuring that that integration, that transparency, that country dialogue is taking place in line with our national strategic plans, because unfortunately that is not the scenario many a times.
Thank you, Lucy. I think you have highlighted a number of a big number of really, really important issues here. And it strikes me when you say and you refer to the treatment action group and the experience that they have built on understanding from a patient perspective. And it's something that we've learned through the AIDS movement, that patients can actually become a voice in the R&D process, and in TB that has started to happen. I think in the typical neglected tropical diseases, we are still as a community struggling to make that happen. But I think it's also there is a need to take the R&D out of the technological ivory tower and bring it to the patients that indeed have a lot to say, that is not necessarily always easily acknowledged, and we are talking different languages, we have to acknowledge that, but do really much more efforts to bridge that, to link it, as John Arna was saying. And I want to actually, you stressed the importance of transparency and accountability in the R&D process, and I think that is something that the R&D community, I think it's new for the R&D community. It's not something that is, in general, we scientists, we think that it's a technological process and it's not necessarily put into a context of transparency and accountability. And I want to jump to Jamie here, because we
heard already a lot about delinking, and one of the often heard critiques or concerns people seem to have with that concept is saying, yeah, but if indeed, as John Arnold was saying, it means also that we need to secure public funding to do the R&D, but R&D is so expensive. I think that it's fair to say that there is not necessarily a full transparency and accountability on the costs of R&D, and I was wondering whether you could speak a little bit to that, Jamie, and make some proposals of how we can improve that transparency, building on the experience we now have in a public and non-profit sector, that at least to understand how, in that context, how much it really costs to do the R&D.
Yes, ma'am. well, I thought that the study by MSF was really interesting because they were looking at this data on drug approvals and disability-adjusted life years and looking at the various proportions. I think that it would be interesting to have another dimension to some of these studies that look at the research priorities that deal with the economic issues of how much is spent in different areas. One of the critical areas are clinical trials. In the area of the clinical trials, there's some areas where you do have some information. You have, for example, a U.S. program which provides a deep subsidy for orphan drugs in the United States where the federal government pays for 50% of the cost of clinical trials. So you have on an annual basis fairly useful information about at least when I went to school, if you knew what half of something cost, you can get to 100% pretty fast. So that's useful. But in terms of the neglected disease research, you have, I think as you mentioned, you have this extensive network of nonprofit institutions which are engaged in research and development. And it would be really helpful if the various PDPs, which get often public funds or charitable contributions to conduct research, would report on a regular basis what they're spending on clinical trials by different phases so you could develop a deeper understanding of the economics. The NIH used to do some of that with cancer research. They used to do a better job than I've done recently, I think, or maybe I'm just missing the data, but we think that publicly funded institutions and charitable organizations like the PDP should be in a helpful kind of a standardized way. They could be reporting. They could do some of this right now. You could also make it more systematic by building into the new WHO R&D Observatory or clinicaltrials.gov or these various registries, the economic things. But it would be good to know certainly what that data is. And could I just mention something on the R&D treaty that the delinkage issue that John Art rose?
1 minute.
Give me 1 minute.
And a half.
I spent 10 years on those issues.
But there are other fora in which you had already ample opportunity to talk about it, so can you summarize it then?
Well, I was in Geneva when the R&D treaty proposal was dealt a real body blow in this closed, secretive, open-ended meeting of member states. And that was the same week that, or right around the same time, the WHO fired everyone that worked for the TDR in Geneva and then offered to hire half of them back. Their personnel went from 100 2 years ago to 60, and then they fired everyone and offered to hire 30 people back. That week, Dr. Margaret Chan, who's the Director General of the WHO, got directly involved in the meeting, almost took over the chairing the meeting, from what we understood, and just demanded that the delegates just remove all the delegates and essentially block until almost the end of her term and Obama's first term any discussion, really, any serious discussion about whether or not you have an R&D treaty or any kind of other agreement that demobilize more money along the lines of what John Art, who's been a fabulous leader in this area, as well as many other people like NGOs like HI, MSF, DNDI, Third World Network, Siri Moon, who's asked a question earlier, people like that. I'm leaving a bunch of people out. She'll kill me if I mention any more. But I think that you know, between laying off your staff that are working on these issues and then trying to block efforts to raise more money, I think that the United States was told early on that any agreement could be written in such a way that it wouldn't cost the United States a nickel because they're already a big funder. And it would really be about mobilizing resources outside the United States. I had people at the State Department told me the reason they wanted to block it is they thought it was an effort to build up the R&D and manufacturing capacity of developing countries, which they saw as competitors. They saw as some big industrial policy negative thing. It got really twisted politically. It's really unfortunate because it's hard to move those issues, and that was really, I think, a big lost opportunity. I would say one thing on delinkage, just to add to this, which I think is quite important. The U.S. Senate passed language calling upon the national academies to study delinkage in the area of antibiotics, HIV drugs, and other drugs. The European Parliament is looking at the area of delinkage as it relates to cancer drugs in Europe. The UNITAID is looking at the area of how to implement delinkage in, as it relates to HIV drugs in developing countries. There are other projects where people are looking at the practical ways. And the first step are cost-benefit analysis to compare the economic scenarios under a delinkage scenario versus a system of granting temporary monopolies and figure out which one has the greatest benefits to society and operates with the most value for money.
Thank you, Jamie. Thank you. And I think what you clearly highlight here is also the importance, the critical importance of having public responsibility and political will to actually drive that agenda. And I want to jump to Christian, or Christian, peut-être, is more appropriate, because we've heard this morning that, for instance, the pipeline today in terms of vaccines research and development seems to be doing pretty well, and there seems to be a feeling that in the field of vaccines, differently than in the field of medicines, there is more political will and an acceptance that it is a public responsibility to ensure that vaccines are being developed, are being made available, and I would like you to speak to that. Like, would you agree with that? And what can we learn of how public responsibility has translated in indeed increased R&D and hopefully an increased output and increased importance for vaccines these past years?
Thank you. Don't expect someone involved in research and development of vaccines to tell you that we have enough money for the development and we have everything that we need.
Certainly not.
I'm going to add something for people that don't know. The International Vaccine Institute is located in Seoul, Korea. So it's a bit of a hybrid organization made of a PDP, research-based organization, but also an organization involved in a lot of capacity building and training, in fact, in many developing countries. And yes, if I look back, in fact, over the past two or three decades, vaccines have achieved, in fact, we have achieved a lot thanks to vaccines. We've seen, and Mark was making the point very, very well this morning, we've got game changer. You know, we've got Gavi, the Gates Foundation, coming into the picture. We've seen, in fact, the coverage coming back to level that had not been seen for a long time. We've seen, in fact, thanks to those organizations, vaccines that were licensed in developed countries being very quickly introduced in developing countries. That's a very important fact. We've seen the possibility to come to, we've seen for the past two and nearly 3 years now, India not having polio cases anymore. We see, in fact, you know, I was remembering, I was mid-July with a friend of mine, we were for a meeting on typhoid. I'll come back to that one later. On typhoid in Kathmandu in Nepal. And we were in the car in the street going to the meeting, and we looked at each other, and we said, are you thinking the same thing? Because we had not been in that place for some time. Yes, we did not see anybody limping on the street. You know, that's something, that's a very important achievement of a global health community in terms of achievement for vaccines. But coming back to another thing, and I would like to come back to what Jean-Hervé said, the diarrheal vaccine are well covered. Coming to the IVI, one of our main piece of work is cholera. I started my career, in fact, when I had black hair, and working on cholera and on an epidemic of cholera in Zaire, in Shaba, you know, Zaire of Mobutu Sese Seko those days. And coming back to cholera, I look around, but I say, for God's sake, it sounds like a failure of global health. We have cholera, and MSF knows that very well. You know, they've been involved in Guinea on an epidemic of cholera. We have epidemic of cholera in Haiti. We have epidemic of cholera in multiple places in Africa. We have them in Bangladesh. We have them in India. And we have a vaccine that was pre-qualified 2 years ago. So what's going on there? We had a vaccine on We have a vaccine on meningitis that has been pre-qualified with a beautiful success. We know what we can do against cholera in terms of, you know, water, wash, one initiative. We could add a vaccine, and that does not happen. What's the problem? Where is the missing link that we need to analyze here in the global health global health community? The second thing that I would like to, in fact, temper a little bit the enthusiasm about vaccine, that developing a vaccine takes time. And unfortunately, you have that dichotomy between the sense of emergency and at the same time, something that we have not yet mentioned today, the regulatory authorities, and where complexity goes up, and goes up all the time. So you need 7 to 10 years to develop a new vaccine. That's something that we need to understand. And that's something that we need very much to take into account. Something that I would like to bring up as well, that is the world where we are, and I think that's something that we need to take into account in the vaccine field. A little bit less than a year ago, a vaccine was licensed for the first time in China against hepatitis E. That's the first time that in, cannot call China a developing country anymore, but it's the first time, you know, usually we see those vaccines, we see our vaccines being made and discovered in the US and Europe and go to developing country to be made at a lower cost. And for the first time, Chinese investment, Chinese research, Chinese vaccine, first vaccine against the disease, that's a big change. That's a big new development coming in this
And
field.
Was it a result of the government of China? Was it a public responsibility-driven response?
Not yet. And that's a vaccine interesting because you need to know that hepatitis E, when it occurs in pregnant women, has a very high level of fatality. In fact, the fatality rate is up to 40% in developing countries when the infection does occur. So there is there certainly an initiative and certainly something that could open up for research and investment from the Chinese government, which is always very sensitive to what's happening in the country. So,
can I stop you here we can come back to you because I want to open it up a little bit further. John Arne, you made this very important plea at the end about how there needed to be more linkage to achieve delinkage, is the way I interpret it. I'm sure you have thought a lot about that and about how to bridge the between the doers and the talkers. And maybe also once we spoke before, you were mentioning that the buy-in from the most affected countries has not necessarily translated yet in a full participation in the thinking and in the process. If you would have one, is there one thing, one suggestion you would have that would make a difference in changing that dynamics, like the one most important thing that need to happen to achieve that?
I think that more or less Lucy mentioned that.
In the microphone,
yeah,
please.
Okay, yeah, sorry. Yeah, I think Lucy more or less mentioned this because I think what we've seen in the HIV/AIDS movement, the real importance of patient voice and the patient voice at all levels, at country level, at regional level, and the global level. And I don't think we have that voice as a strong way. So it's not seen in the media in most of our countries. And I think that's the most important mover.
That's very helpful. And Carlos, maybe you want to also... You've been an observer and participant in this whole field, both at the global level and in Brazil. And I think that there are quite a number of questions about why in Brazil, where, I mean, there is a scientific and technological base, there is major health needs, there is political will from the government, there is relatively, I mean, good financing available. What has not yet happened in Brazil to take that one step forward? Is it also related to not enough patient voice, or are there other factors based on the experience in Brazil that you would like to highlight here that need to be tackled?
I would say, on the positive side, I think political will was very critical during several stages in Brazil. For instance, the new constitution, the 88 constitution, says that health is an obligation of the state and the right of the citizen. So this completely changed the landscape in health. But there are other areas which are not enough just to make a new law or a new constitution. Brazil has suffered since long from the linkage between the R&D and the production. If you compare Brazil and Korea, for instance, two indicators, production of papers and patents go up smoothly in Korea. Brazil, we have a very high scientific production, but almost no technological production internally. And this comes from the culture after the Second World War, when the report science without science, frontless, frontier without frontiers from the US government put a lot of emphasis on basic research. And Brazil sort of copied this in another context. So we put a lot of basic research, but much less in technology. So I would say today this is one of the things that harms a bit. Our innovation law was from 2005, while the United States was from 1980, so 25 years late. But I would like to agree with the pressure from patients, pressure from the media, pressure from the interest groups can have a big, can make a big difference. And that's why the HIV movement in Brazil was so successful, due to a law obliging to treat all patients HIV positive. So this was a conquer of society in general.
Thank you for that. I think that's a recurrent theme that I think is certainly something that all of us, because, I mean, whether you're a policy researcher, a drug developer, we can all do much more advocacy for achieving our goals. It's not only in the laboratories that we work. We can actually join forces with the patient advocates and in all that. And I want to come back to something that, or to the presentation of Jean Hervé, and where we got a really nice, very interesting analysis about, but which to some extent was a counting of the number of products, and of course you mentioned it, that has certain limitations because the numbers don't tell you everything. And in previous or other conversations, you have often mentioned that medical innovation is much more broader than just counting the number of products. And what we need to be looking at is how do we create therapeutic advances that are actually meaningful at the patient and health practitioner level. And it's actually a question for both Lucy and Jean Hervé. Like in trying to bridge Jean-Hervé, you from a health practitioner, Lucy from a patient side, in trying to bridge that gap that has been described with the research community, what would you tell the research community on how they can think about their work such that what we get is really the therapeutic advance at the patient level as a result of this whole process and not just a number in a list of a product? Jean-Hervé, you want to start?
Well, I think the first step is acknowledging failure, if you want, an innovation. If you take the example of tuberculosis, 10 years ago, we were said that we were not in need of new drugs, that the situation could be controlled with existing products. So that's the first step. The second step, which is immediately behind, is to identify an alternative. That's where new products play an important role, because if you have a failure but no alternative, it's just a constraint, not a problem, because there is no potential solution. Then it's a long chain of action starting, setting trials, publishing them, identifying producers, checking over their quality, obtaining good prices, writing protocols, training staff, organizing the supply, the distribution, organizing the supervision, etc., etc. It's a very long chain of action if you want to obtain a significant coverage with your new proposal in real time. But there is a very critical moment if you want to reach a certain scale, is to have an economic model, because at market condition, at existing market condition, you know, none of the major innovation over the past decades, on vaccine is one of them, vaccine of API, would have occurred without a specific economic model at the launch of initiative. Because, for instance, for vaccines, after the launch in the 70s of the expanded program, immunization program, vaccine prices were divided by 20 or 30. The same for contraception, for instance, for family planning. If you want, when it was under consideration to spread over those products, you know, prices were divided by 50, sometimes 100. So that's a very critical moment on keeping in mind that regimes, government, they react to mainly three types of stimulation. The first one is public safety. They're in charge of public safety. They exchange collecting taxes against public safety. So that's a stimulation for them. Second one is the economics, potential economic gains or losses. And the third one is their own stability. Where we were successful with HIV, my last sentence, it's because we messed up with WTO negotiations. So we were potentially armoring some expected economic gains. So that's why it gave us a tool to be in a better position to negotiate access, prices, and all of that.
Lucy, you want to comment?
I guess I'll use the example of TBHIV.
Can you move the microphone a bit closer?
I'm just saying I'll use the example of TBHIV and why this becomes really important in terms of talking to the patients, getting to find out what their needs are. Because many a times, when you think about the drug-to-drug interactions, this is something that is basically felt at the patient level. And many a times, I guess one of the things that needs to be dealt with is really having those candid conversations to find out from the patients what kind of drugs would you want to see in the future. And I guess one thing that would stand out if it was for TB drugs is, I mean, if you'd get a drug that would be used within 5 days, so be it. But the reality I know is that we may not get shorter regimens, maybe in the next 5 years, maybe down to 4 months, which is still progress. Think about the aspect of MDR-TB, where patients today are actually taking treatment for a period of 2 years with really bad side effects. The other day, I was out in the field, and it was sad that this was an MDR patient who had been discharged from the facility. And it was unfortunate because, one, he was never given information about the potential side effects of the drugs. And within a short time of starting his MDR treatment, he ended up becoming deaf. And it was really a huge challenge because once you get MDR-TB, the side effects are enormous. There are scenarios whereby if you don't have a community-based approach, then the only way out is isolation facilities. And therefore, thinking about it more in terms of preparing the patients and making them understand and also preparing the community so that communities are better prepared to really know this is the consequences of bad programming, because at the end of the day, whether we like it or not, we know that MDR is basically a man-made problem. And I guess if we had started 20 or 30 years ago in terms of ensuring that patients were aware about the importance of completing treatments, because I think for me that's the added benefit in having known that once I started antiretroviral therapy, then it actually basically meant that this was lifelong treatment. And from the very first day till to date, I don't think I've ever defaulted on taking my medication, and I'm still on first line treatment. And therefore, it means that as a patient, I took very keenly the advice I was given by the healthcare workers, and I also did a lot of research on my own to understand what were the potential implications and even the side effects on the medications I'm taking. And I don't think that's really information that has been broadened at a large scale level, and therefore much more needs to go into that. And then of course, combining the issue of having patients participate within the community advisory boards and also ensuring that their voice is heard when designing programs. Just giving an example the other day, whereby we now have the TB vaccines going into phase two, and it was quite interesting to visit the Kisumu site in Kenya, western part of Africa, and actually listen to the community and some of the patients, what this really meant for them, and them being receptive to really saying, I would want to participate because I really understand what this means for me, vis-a-vis scenarios where we've seen bad programming whereby we've had women having to undergo forced sterilization just because they're HIV positive. So there are actually pros and cons of how best should we change the scenarios that we are in, so that at the end of the day, one, the research needs are basically tailored to what's best for the patients, because I don't think any researcher out there would really want to have drugs that would have potential side effects, because at the end of the day, whether we like it or not, TB is an airborne condition and we are all connected by the air that we breathe, and therefore, the more seriously we think about some of those small messages when designing some of our research protocols, then it would go a long, long way. If it's happened to me, it could happen to anyone else.
Thank you so much. And I want to open it up for questions and comments, brief ones from the floor. So if you can walk to the microphones. But in the meanwhile, what is interesting that no one so far in this panel has mentioned it, but Dr. Fauci this morning alluded to the real critical importance of management of all the different complicated aspects that bear to research and development, and that so far or until recently, most of this management capacity to take products through the whole pipeline resides with pharmaceutical industry. But I think what we've been learning is that actually we can, in the non-profit product development partnerships and sometimes in the public sector, we can learn how to drive and manage research and development. And I think this is a really important aspect that we need to, it's not sufficient to just say, well, I have a nice idea, well, let's put it into development. It's really complicated to develop a new drug or a new vaccine, as anyone in this room who is involved in that will easily agree with. And the management capacity to bring it all together is not something we used to have in the public sector, but we start now to learn through the PDPs at least how to do it outside or in collaboration with pharmaceutical companies, because we learn a lot from pharmaceutical companies. But I think that this is a critical element that we as a community need to build more of. And I cannot clearly see, yes, I see two questions there. Go ahead.
Hi.
Can you please say who you are?
I will, yes. I'm Sophie Blumen. I work with Health Action International Europe. Thank you all for your presentations. I have a question for Jorn Arne Rottingen. Thank you for your very clear and insightful presentation on the possible framework for R&D. I was just wondering, you showed us what were the consultative expert working group's recommendations, and then which were quite ambitious and included a framework and sustainable financing and models that would, proposals that would have delinkage. And then you showed us shortly the resolution of the open-ended, or the draft resolution of the open-ended member stage, which had some elements in there, but was, compared to your recommendations, quite minimalistic, I would say. So still you call it a success. So I was wondering how you see that, and if you see this as a stepping stone towards a framework and towards sustainable financing, or just how you see it, and maybe other panelists also have thoughts on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Sophie. And I propose we take first a few questions and then we have the panel to respond. So we remain at the same microphone. Yes, go ahead.
I'm Abul Fayez from Bangladesh. After listening to the panel, particularly John Harp, about the fatal imbalance update, I could not prevent my temptation to say a couple of words and then ask a question. If I listen correctly, the lack of political commitments, lack of patients' voices, no product in the pipeline, no new diagnostics, no new drugs, over and above, even the existing drugs are not utilized, possibly after such considerations, he rightly mentioned that no focus at all in some of the neglected diseases. Possibly those are the conditions he tried to ventilate. One of the infant neglected tropical disease, so-called disease, is snake bite. Currently, every year in India, more than 45,000 patients die. In the neighboring country of India, Bangladesh, there are 6,000 deaths per year. Possibly, this could be considered as most neglected of all neglected diseases. What are the possible thinking of the MSF and DNDI or the organizers in this particular area? Because the neglected diseases you are considering, and unfortunately there is no patient's voice, there is no pharmaceutical company, there is no political commitment. After considering all the criteria, possibly this is the most neglected amongst neglected diseases. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move to the other microphone. Hi. Yes.
Hi, I'm Joshua Cohen, Tufts University. First, I want to thank the presenters, fantastic presentations, but also an interesting panel discussion. The linkage was very interesting, the theme of linkage. And I see several linkages, I'm sure others see more. One linkage, for instance, between R&D funding and actual drug development and product development. I think that's important. I do sometimes think that's overemphasized. I think one of the more important linkages is between the drug development or the actual approvals and access. Now, I think there has been improvement over the last 10 years, but it is fragmented, it's fractured, it's not systematic. And surely sustainable funding of R&D is important, but I think just as important is sustainable funding of getting delivery mechanisms, supply chains, getting the correct drugs, obviously, to the right patients at the right time. And that's something that's sometimes a little underemphasized. I just wanted to make that comment.
Thank you so much. We have a last comment or question, and then we'll go back to the panel.
Yeah, thanks, Frank, MSF in Germany. And thanks also for the presentations here. And I can just say that I'm absolutely comfortable with what has said before. And I sometimes have the impression also that I lack a little bit the feeling of urgency at this moment. When I hear, for instance, that the R&D treaty, the ideas, let's say, behind that, and the analyses have been shared very much on WHO grounds, and everybody agrees something has to be done. And then I hear in 2016 is the next moment when you're going to start to rediscuss maybe about it. Then I can only say, well, this is a death sentence for a lot of people who in between would have maybe becoming sick and not getting the right treatment at the right time. So this is, as from a medical doctor point of view, not acceptable. And it looks a little bit like in the late 90s somehow, when it was clear statements, even by WHO, others who said very clearly, don't go for ARV treatment in areas where the economic situation is not allowing to doing so. And I feel maybe it's time to push the boundaries again, and that is incorporating all of us sitting here and saying, well, isn't it time to really have a, let's say, coalition of the willings to push the boundaries on the political, on the economic, and let's put also the white elephant in the room on the table. It's a pharmaceutical industry which is making enormous gains in this area and is so much afraid of really being challenged, and that has been very clearly put forward by Jamie Love, and I think that's also my question. To him, then, to directly, do you think there is an option, and what are we doing until 2016? Thanks.
Thank you. So I think, John Arnes, some questions are clearly for you. So maybe you want to kick off, and then I don't know whether there was a specific question to any of the panelists about coming from Bangladesh. I can't see anymore where. Ah, yes. Was it to a specific panel? Member that you wanted to ask your question? Okay, so if you want to think, anyone can take that next.
Yeah, thank you, and thanks for the question. I appreciate that Sophie Bloom from Health Action International called the recommendations of the Consultative Expert Working Group for ambitious. I think we were ambitious, but also realistic, and what I see in the draft resolution now is more or less follow-up on most of the thinking and the principles. So I guess it's partly, do we see that glass as half empty or half full? My kind of nature of thinking is always thinking half full. But what was ambitious, and in a way it was useful as a way of framing the need for one sustainable mechanism, that was the R&D treaty or the convention that we proposed. That was a mechanism for implementation. So what I see now is that the recommendations that are there is kind of on the table still, but we don't see the clear implementation plan. And to be honest, we wouldn't expect the kind of the busy negotiators from 100 and plus countries managing to make an implementation plan over a couple of days meeting. But I think we need to challenge countries now, because I would like to believe what they are saying and not start thinking about what kind of pressures they have in their back, but actually just take their words. And the words I'm hearing is that countries would like to continue this agenda and would like to continue and make efforts in this area. And we heard in the previous session this morning that there was a down period of the in the vaccine world in the early 90s due to lack of financing. And I think it's really now the issue of financing. And what I would like to see is that we have a coalition of commitment from some key countries, and I would be happy to name countries. I think we should, the USA is an important contributor in this field, but it's not enough just to say that we are kind of delivering and others should start delivering. USA needs to take leadership and bring other countries on board. I haven't seen that. I would like to see Brazil, India to take leadership as well. Kind of being a part of negotiation landscape in Geneva for many years, the kind of USA, Brazil, India has been on the different sides. I think what I'm hearing is that this agenda is important for both those that side of the divide of discussions. So I would like to see that kind of leadership. And we heard this morning that what really changed the vaccine field was a new player coming in. That was the Gates Foundation. Of course, we know that the Gates Foundation is the second largest funder when you kind of compare public and philanthropy in this area. But what I haven't seen is Gates Foundation's willingness to engage in dialogue and real commitment together with public entities and governments. I would like to see that. Bill Gates himself is calling for more investment from governments, but then the Gates Foundation needs to step up and kind of start the dialogue. So a commitment of a coalition of commitment between key countries and the Gates Foundation getting on board and being engaged in the discussion.
Anyone wants to react, Jean-Hervé? Yes.
I want to give a bit of an answer to my Bengali colleague. The pipes for neglected tropical diseases isn't empty today. You have several tens of products still under development, including five new chemical entities, one for onchocerciasis, one for Chagas, and one for sleeping sickness, plus two for Ebola on Marburg. So we are far from a satisfactory situation, but there is an improvement. But that's true that clinical situation like snake bites, you know, are still very neglected, and we include this pathology in our list. And over the past 12 years, we found only one product dedicated to this very common pathology.
I think there are no more further questions, that people are probably starting to feel very hungry. So I want to thank all the panelists for this excellent contribution. Sorry?